You're going to need to listen to this with your intuition. So this is for those who have those ears to hear it. It's an intuitive sort of vision. If you can get an intuitive vision, don't analyze it too much, because this is very sophisticated, high-level information that came in today. Because I've been able to keep the good habits going, refrain from getting off track, suddenly today I just was flooded with this overall new context of understanding that I'm just still absorbing it. I'll try to pass it on for those, because time is short, for sure. And how I can pass it on, I don't know. It's really quite something. It requires all sorts of various basic understandings before it kind of all clicks together. But in a nutshell, you could say that existence, material existence, is really a kind of an attempt, is a way of saying spaciousness, pure spaciousness, is going to run out of space. So it's kind of, we're trying to like shrink our life down into a tight little container by saying this pure spaciousness doesn't have enough space for us, so we're going to, again, constrict ourselves. Constrict our spirit, constricts itself down into this, all the way down to like a physical body, and even more so, where like physical bodies are compacted together, like in Tokyo or something like that. I used to live in Japan, and it drove me crazy because I couldn't stand the compaction of everything. It was just absolutely horrible. I said, I got to get out of here. And going back to California, you know, I just love wide open spaces where you just feel you can just expand, you know. So what is this flesh-based material? What is materiality? It is literally, it's spirit saying, I need to constrict myself so I can fit in to spaciousness, because spaciousness is going to run out of space, and I won't have enough space, so I got to make sure I'm very constricted. This is one way of looking at it. And this actually brings about a remedy for us, because when we can accept the fact that pure spaciousness can never run out of space at all, we can then expand ourselves. Spirit can give up this constriction and start to expand. You've heard the phrase, you know, walk into the light, meaning expand yourself. Allow yourself to feel expanded instead of constricted. We feel constricted thinking that we're learning how to fit into a smaller space than normal. We feel that the expansion of spirit somehow is going to go beyond pure spaciousness. So it's a dangerous type of thing. We'll fall into an abyss, we'll go beyond it. I think Lonchenpa mentioned that many people think that pure spaciousness is an abyss. But why would they think that? Only if they thought that they were going to somehow go beyond it, which implies it has a boundary, right? So when spirit said, hey, I want to be prime creator, it automatically thinks that reality has a boundary to it, pure spaciousness has a boundary to it, which is not true. And thinking it has a boundary, then it starts freaking out, say, oh my gosh, I'm going to fall off the edge of pure spaciousness into an abyss. I need to begin to constrict what I am, and then eventually be constricted all the way down into this little, you know, clay, this little vessel of dust we call the body. But once you see this, you suddenly say, it's a game changer. You say, hey, wait a minute, I can unconstrict myself. And then the fear of death, fear, all this stuff is going to vanish, because you realize it's only a constriction, it's not necessary. And then you can walk into the light and expand, and there's no more worries about trying to figure out how to live in this constricted world, such a constricted world, getting constricted all the time, more and more and more and more, right? Where I live is a shark tank, literally, and they're throwing more and more sharks in the tank constantly. It is so constricted. I was just driving home today. It was like 3 o'clock or something, and getting to a light and nobody could move. It was so gridlocked. It was gridlock. It's the middle of the day, gridlock. I said, what is going on here? It's just like, people are just, and I try to go around some cars, and I need to try to go through. Everything gets very, very messy as far as driving goes, and the boundaries. What I like is a place where you can just look out, and you just see a lot of space. Things are clearly delineated in space. There's room between everything. You just feel a sense of expansion. I don't like the idea of living in cramped, sit with lots of people around you, real cramped, and lots of cars, and just, terrible, terrible. So, there are some places in the world that does make a difference where you live. This is a question I've been asking myself today, and we've sort of been talking about this the last couple of videos. You know, does it make a difference where you live, where you are? It does. It does, because there are many places where you feel extremely constricted, and people actually like that because they think, okay, I'm working on learning how to constrict myself, what I am, into a smaller and smaller and smaller area, so that'll save me from falling into the abyss. And so when they see the wide open areas and stuff, they go, ah, too much. I need to get back to my little cubicle. I like driving through, you know, just drive and see just wide open, vast vistas. And just feeling like, this is so, I just feel like I could just expand into it, you know, just expand into it. So when you're in a place where it's that way, you begin to, it's easier to feel, hey, maybe I should start expand, see myself more as light, you know, that expand, something that's expansive instead of just this little constricted piece of flesh, which is we're only identifying with it out of fear of going into the abyss beyond pure spaciousness, beyond endlessness. There is no abyss. So once we can kind of get that and accept it, there's no reason to identify with the body anymore. You can start expanding. You can start expanding. And some people have done that to greater or lesser extent. So I would say the best place to live is a place where you can look out and your view is not blocked. You know, you can see for miles and miles and miles and miles. You can see not too many trees. You're not like you're living in some forest, you know. Living in a forest is a very constricted feeling, I found. It's kind of a womb-like feeling. You're really constricted underneath all these trees. I'd be able to look out in expansive vistas. Maybe the tree here, shrub here, that little plant there. Everything is delineated against this spaciousness. So spaciousness should be primarily what you're seeing. And I think that is helpful. It is helpful to see that. Not so good to live in a very constricted, confined, everything's blocked, all your views are blocked. Lots of people swarming around you, cars, activity, it's all, you know, not so good. So this whole material realm is unnecessary, actually. It's a constriction. On purpose, Spirit is doing it. God did not constrict us. Spirit said, oh my gosh, I want to be prime creator, but whoops, that means there's an abyss. I better avoid the abyss. How do I do that? Oh my gosh, if I'm spirit, I'm just going to expand into it. You know, I'm going to fall into it. I better find myself as a person, a body on a little planet somewhere. And that feels safer to spirit. So if you can kind of intuitively understand what I'm talking about, there could be an aha moment. And then I'm just letting it sink in. I'm just saying, hey, this is really a big time game changer. It's like the fear of death could just vanish. Could just vanish. Absolutely vanish. When you step into an expansion and you experience yourself in an expanded state. And you say, hey, I like this better. This is wonderful. And then what is the body? But it's just like a pair of shoes or something, you know, at that point. Because you don't feel like you need to identify with it anymore. You don't need to identify with constriction. So we'll see how this goes. We'll see what kind of a game changer it is. And it's a very timely thing. But again, as I was pressing this issue of, does it matter where we are? You know, finally this total answer, more than I expected, came. And it does help. It can help. It can help absolutely where you are. And just the vibe, the sense of spaciousness that you're getting from where you are, you can get into this mood where, like, wow, you know, I feel like I'm spacious instead of so constricted. And that can be very helpful. As I said, Franklin Merrill Wolfe's little house, where I went up to that house one day, and it looks out over this vast spaciousness. You know, it's just like, wow, beautiful. Beautiful spaciousness. Alabama Hills and then Owens Valley to the south, and it's just this Mount Whit, I mean, all the high Eastern Sierra right behind them, you know, it's just this incredible vista of spaciousness, just awesome. That's where he lived, you know, Franklin Merrill Wolfe, you can, W-O-L-F-F-E, I think, something like that. You can look it up. He was a great American mystic, actually, who experienced expansion into spaciousness, consciousness without an object. So he was not one of the heavyweights like Longchenpa or Anandamayi or Manaharshi, Jesus, etc. But he was certainly a quite a profound mystic. And then, of course, Longchenpa's cave in the Tibetan mountains, I saw his course cave is, looking out, oh my God, the vistas are just unbelievable. Spaciousness, tremendous, tremendous sense of spaciousness looking out for. He did most of his writings in a cave. So, hey, see, you look at these top mystics and oftentimes they are in a place that is extraordinarily spacious. So we'll see how this continues to unfold and blossom, because this is a context changer. It gives the answer to what is this material existence. It is an intentional contraction out of fear of falling into the abyss based on spirit's desire to be prime creator, which automatically then puts a limit on God. Say God, there's some place where God ends and this new creation creator begins, which means that there's a fear of an abyss. And we're trying to avoid that abyss by contraction into these ridiculous, you know, flesh suits that were causing us all sorts of problems and sicknesses and surgeries and all these issues. And, you know, it's a nightmare. We're not stuck with it. We're not stuck with it. We can actually start dropping the contraction and start expanding, feeling expansion. And what I noticed is driving around today, I was able to get a faint sense of the blessed world, the vision of the blessed world, where everything was already abiding in pure spaciousness, and I could sense it, I could feel it, as it were, everything without exception. And then what happened was, all sorts of very subtle, expansive, beautiful, subtle qualities began arising. You know, just like wow, and I felt like, oh, there's an expansion. And I say, what happens? Did you just perceive pure spaciousness, or is that it, or what? No, it gets filled up with these expanding beauty. Beauty expands from this constricted, like a constricted house. You're looking at a house or plant. When you begin to release it from its constriction, you begin to feel this subtle, like almost like an infinite chain of a beautiful, subtle. You can't even really reify it or explain exactly what it is, but it's very beautiful and profound subtleties begin to arise, and that's the expansion. Okay, so if you allow expansion to happen, you get this whole realm of very beautiful subtle qualities that spirit is delighted in this, no question about it, because that's moving towards back to our true condition, which is pure expansion, spirit, within pure spaciousness. So starting to get some, you know, positive movement in that direction. And again, we'll see how tomorrow goes. I'll keep this one short. And that's it for this one. All right.